is a hope to all who seek. Light is a way when moments are bleak. So look up to the skies, the light is Jesus Christ, and all who we seek will find. Na 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 na.
Dear sisters and brothers, a joyous and grace-filled welcome to you all for another session of our wisdom series, Lucius Sicut Luminare. Be lights in order to illuminate. You might be wondering where I suddenly disappeared after extending a cordial welcome to you, leaving you with just a picture of a burning candle before your eyes. Friends, the light emanating from the burning candle and the light that surrounds me are very important for me and for you, my esteemed audience. Without light, this lecture would not be possible. Why am I talking about burning candle or light? Because my topic for the day is becoming light, path of self-actualization. Light is one of the basic necessities of our lives. No light means no life, no hope, and no future. Scientists rightly say, stop light for a few days and you will see this planet dead and barren again. Therefore, it is not surprising that in all religions, societies and ethnic communities, light has been used as a powerful sign and an appropriate symbol of the divine presence amidst them. What impelled them to keep it at such a high pedestal? It is because they saw and experienced its tremendous energy that transforms everything, and saw it as a force that possesses power to create or to devour. With these few basic insights, let me go to the core of my topic, which I intend to explain in two parts. First, becoming light, and second, understanding self-actualization. For better reflection, I am taking second part first, and then I will go to the first part. So, self-actualization, general understanding. We all know that the true beauty of a bud is seen only when it blooms into a beautiful flower. This could be seen as a pictorial or vivid explanation of self-actualization. The world is naturally oriented towards perfection and excellence. We all participate in that high-pitched race with so much intensity that right from our education to profession, complexion to ornamentation, and motivation to dedication, we seek nothing less than the optimum. Only optimum level. Yes, in simple words, it is a process wherein a person gradually evolves and magnificently prospers into a fulfilled person. He or she becomes a delight to the eyes and a treat to our expectations. Psychosociological understanding. In psychology, self-actualization is a term coined by German neurologist and organismic theorist Kurt Goldstein. He coined it to explain the motive to realize one's full potential. He called it as a basic drive. In Abraham Maslow's hierarchy of needs, it is the highest level of psychological development of a human person. According to Maslow, every person carries in him or her the desire for the full realization of one's potential and of one's true self. In simple terms, he says that it is the intrinsic growth of what is already in the organism, or more accurately, of what is the organism itself. In our society, people who have truly actualized carry an added badge of respect and admiration. Certainly, they deserve it. An honest applause from everyone is a sign of sincere recognition of their hard work and dedication. They are also a powerful source of inspiration to all those who aspire to reach greater heights of excellence in their lives. Religious understanding. Understanding of self-actualization in the religious context has a different connotation or orientation. In Catholicism, it is laden deeply into its notion of beatific vision. It is nothing but a heavenly state wherein we will have a very personal encounter with our Lord face to face. There is nothing that will surpass it in its splendor and glory. In Hinduism, we see that the notion of self-actualization consists in attaining moksha, the ultimate goal to be realized after the three other ends of life, namely artha, meaning wealth, kama, meaning pleasure, and dharma, duty. It is different from Catholicism in the sense that it teaches about the presence of the state of paripurna brahmanubhava, the experience of oneness with Brahman, the supreme self. It is a state of knowledge, peace and bliss. In Buddhism, the same idea can be seen in the concept of nirvana. It is the end of all agonies and cessation of desire, hatred and ignorance. It is the state of highest happiness attained through balance, poise and unruffled state of mind. Buddhism teaches us that nirvana is attained by following the eightfold path of right understanding, right thoughts, right speech, right actions, right livelihood, right efforts, right mindfulness, and right concentration. Islam speaks about Jannat, the paradise, as a garden of everlasting bliss and home of peace that every Muslim longs to attain at the end of his or her life. However, I would say that the Islamic concept of ideal self is very much close to the idea of self-actualization. It states that every good deed a person is encouraged to do and every evil that he is forbidden to do are the means of becoming ideal self. Second part, becoming light. Dear friends, a simple reflection on the above insights brings out one point very clearly, that self-actualization is the final fulfillment of attaining something which is very precious and valuable. No doubt, religious understanding focuses on afterlife, but it is very much related to our life here on this earth. It involves a continuous, committed effort in enhancing the quality of our spirituality and virtuous life. In other words, it is nothing else but our resolve of becoming light in this world. It entails a process which has four aspects. First, self-examination. Second, energizing force. Third, readiness to sacrifice. And fourth, quest for glowing. Self-examination. Can we imagine education without examination or diagnosis without checkup? We might use different ways of examination. However, without them, the world would suffer from deficiency of proper growth and development. If examination is essential for our growth, self-examination is equally necessary on our journey of becoming light. It is like looking ourselves in the mirror. Who am I? Am I light or darkness? If light, how much glow do I have? Am I just a flickering flame or a flicker of hope for those who are struggling with hopelessness? On the other side, if I am darkness, since when I have fallen in that doom state? And till what point of time will I continue? Aristotle says, knowing yourself is the beginning of all wisdom. Socrates goes still further and warns, an unexamined life is not worth living. Dear friends, sincere examination of our lives is the need of the hour. In our rich religious traditions like examination of conscience, inner healing exercises and sacrament of confession serve as channels of grace that bring about noteworthy renewal in our lives. Prophets stressed on it. Saint Paul too echoed himself with the prophets when he exhorted, test everything, hold fast to what is good. 1 Thessalonians 5:21. In calling Pharisees and scribes like whitewashed tomb, Jesus wanted them to do self-examination. But pity, they were hard-hearted. They lost the opportunity to light their extinguished candle once again. Pope Francis rightly says, the biggest problem of this age is not just sin, but the loss of sense of sin. In other words, humanity does not bother to know where her feet are. In our mission of becoming light, let's imbibe humbly and honestly the value of self-examination. Energizing force. The quality of light depends on appropriate and sufficient fuel. What is it that I am trying to highlight here? We need to have good fuel to glow our lives. Thomas Monson, an American author, says, we tend to become like those we admire. Therefore, we have to expose ourselves to people of good qualities and virtues. We have to be wise while acquiring knowledge, cherishing experiences, and retaining memories. Sometimes we may lose some of our glow. Science tells us that even the sun is shrinking. We have to refuel ourselves regularly with psycho-spiritual exercises. Our Lord, in John 14:6, authoritatively tells us that He is the way, the truth, and the life. In other words, He is the authentic and irreplaceable fuel for our lives. But the tragedy is that, in spite of the Savior's call to us to remain attached to Him, like the branches to the vine, in all our needs, we sometimes try to root ourselves in wrong places. We end up absorbing everything, good manure as well as bad, water as well as poison, and then come to realize with deep regret that the end result is terrible and frustrating. The need of the hour is to be convinced of developing an intimate bonding with Jesus our Lord, source of our life and life in abundance. Readiness to sacrifice. What has the sun achieved by radiating its light since inception? Forget about the sun. What does this light around us gain when it is shining to enlighten the path of our life? Nothing. Absolutely nothing. It appears and it just disappears. No gain, no appreciation, no reward. It just travels. And while traveling, it just illumines. That's it. What a marvelous self-giving. What an awe-inspiring sacrifice. If light that has no life and heart can do so much to others, imagine the intensity of our radiance. Saint Paul, illuminating the nature of our giving, says, God loves a cheerful giver. 2 Corinthians 9:7. Mother Teresa says, what matters is not just giving, but the way you are giving it. Give till it hurts. Maximilian Kolbe gave his own life to save a family man. Our Lord Jesus Christ sacrificed his life for the sake of all, Jews as well as Samaritans, healthy as well as sick and lepers. No one can surpass Jesus' sacrifice. In his birth, life and death, it is a sacrifice par excellence. In the book of Ecclesiastes, the teacher says, vanity of vanities, all is vanity. However, sacrificing ourselves for the sake of others is certainly not vanity. It is a virtue. There lies our greatness, our worth, and our future. We shall receive reward hundredfold. Quest for glowing. Glowing is a virtue. However, while glowing, our intention has to be good. Here, let me stress on two important points. One, our goal has to be to illumine others sincerely and responsibly. We cannot become light in order to expose nakedness of others. And second, our focus has to be to make others glow fully and legitimately. We cannot become light or fire in order to burn others. Let me make myself clear by stating the fact that by nature, certain things require less light. Therefore, too much light or unnecessary light damages their natural growth or peaceful existence. We should keep this notion in our minds. A famous French philosopher, Immanuel Levinas, in his Ethics of Face-to-Face Encounter, teaches us that in giving due respect to others, we command greater respect to our own selves. In elevating others, we are elevated higher. Our motive has to be noble, our execution sincere, and our end selfless. Jesus is the light of lights. With his own light, he could have easily exposed the sin of the woman caught in adultery and stoned her thereafter. But the way he actualized himself was marvelous. He gave his measured light to that woman, the drooping branch, and there occurred the miracle wherein the drooping branch became a rejuvenated one, full of life. That branch bore abundant fruit. Of those who were standing there as the righteous ones, he could right every sin of them. However, he gave an opportunity to them also, and miracle. They acknowledged that they too were sinners, and they left one after the other, beginning with the elders. Why? Because Jesus gave his light, measured light. Let us become light that is sufficient, necessary, and transforming for a good cause. Conclusion. Dear friends, it is only because of the sun that the moon shines. Let us become little suns, illuminating lifeless moons who are living all around us, the marginalized, downtrodden, weary and burdened. They are the objects of our becoming light. Our journey of self-actualization begins there, and it reaches its goal only in heaven, when we shall have a beatific vision of God. Let us then cherish our identity, that we are created in the image and likeness of God, that we are called to walk with God, and that we are destined to live in heaven forever with God. Thank you. God bless you.